All right, welcome to the show, everybody. We got a show for you. I'm Donald W. Moore. I started Get Off My Lawn Records, and I'm a guitarist. Apparently, I do more than jazz.
Apparently.
I just did a country gig out in Round Top yesterday.
Good for you.
Town of 98 people.
98, really?
Yeah, population 98. But that's because they do the census during the week. It's a lot of weekenders out there. They got a big antique show coming up that's going to be a lot of fun. Hopefully we'll book some shows out there doing some country, doing some jazz.
Okay.
So I do that. I make records, right? Started Get Off My Lawn. This actually started originally as Left Nut Records.
Yes.
And if you go back farther than that, it was D Music Records, but then D Music Incorporated bought my URL. So...
Did you make some money off it, at least?
I did. I made a couple hundred dollars.
Which probably promptly got spent on gear.
Yeah, let's call it gear. So who the bleep are you? You're sitting over there razzing me.
I would be your wife.
That's right. I'm not sure. I can't really tell if your face is being covered up by the microphone this week or not. We're trying some new stuff.
Yeah, I can't tell either.
Yeah, we're trying some new stuff. We're seeing how this goes. We got these spiffy new, what'd you call them, spring arm?
Yeah.
I just call them radio mic stands. Because you'll see these in radio stations, right? Like when I was on KOOP, this was the kind of stand they were using. Except nicer. These are cheap. So welcome to the show, everybody. We got a show for you. If this is your first time, welcome. Be sure to hit subscribe. We do a weekly show. It's really hard. I do a lot of other things, and like this week, the show's feeling a little more like a chore than normal.
Well, yeah, because you played all day yesterday.
All day, on my feet.
You're exhausted.
I did two shows, 2 hours long each, and I didn't take a break, neither. Mm-hmm. Well, I took a break on the second one for like 5 minutes, but yeah, I did 2 hours straight, took 3 hours off, did another 2 hours. And it was an hour drive out and an hour drive back. It worked pretty hard.
It was all day.
But they paid us well,
yep.
Which is good. And we'll talk about our announcements and things. So section two is going to be Carissa Explains It All.
Yes.
Because that's who the bleep you are.
Uh-huh.
And then after that, we're gonna talk to Kyle Sherrod, who sold me my Tascam 688.
Yes.
And I got a text message today. He's ready to sell me his 238.
Yes.
So, that's pretty cool. I'm excited about that.
Hey, as long as it's here in time for the Great Rewire of 2017.
Yeah. Hopefully.
If it's not, we're going to have to postpone the Great Rewire because you're going to want that wired in.
Yeah. Well, that's why I'm getting it, is so that I can wire it into the rack.
Yeah.
Rather than try to... Like, this, the 688 is just bulky in the room.
Yep.
So we'll talk to Kyle. We'll talk to Kyle in section three. Then we'll come in. We'll talk about. We'll do our announcements, our goals, and a giveaway.
Yes.
So hang out for that.
Yes.
And then then we'll go back and we'll talk to Kyle some more. Kyle did some very interesting. He just did a film, where he scored a film. He's made some records. Friends with a guy from Slipknot. Real interesting guy.
Okay.
Also a tape dork like me. So.
Okay.
So after our announcements, we'll talk to Kyle some more. Then we'll do our shout-outs.
Yep.
So if you would like a shout-out, be sure to leave a comment below and hit the thumbs up. Obviously, it helps a lot when you leave comments and hit thumbs up. And then after our shout-outs is our final section. Everybody gets a trophy. So hang out for Everybody Gets a Trophy. And welcome to the show. So let's move on to section two. Carissa Explains It All. What are you explaining today? Capacitors?
Capacitors.
We talked about this last week that I wanted you to explain capacitors because of condenser microphones.
Yes.
Or you were calling them capacitor microphones.
Well, I said they can be called capacitor microphones.
You're very quiet, so you have to either get that microphone closer to you or talk louder.
Is this better?
Yeah, that's better.
Okay.
Not really.
I was trying to keep it out of my face. But,
well,
you know.
Pick it up. Physically up. There, up.
All right, now it's right in my line of sight.
That's good.
Okay.
You're getting better signal.
Better signal. Okay, that's always good. Okay, so capacitors. What is a capacitor? A capacitor is a two-terminal electrical component that stores electrical energy in an electric field. Simple. Very simple.
So you pipe electricity into it and it holds on to it.
Yep.
Okay.
So the effect of a capacitor is called capacitance.
How does it hold the electricity?
Well, I'm getting to that.
Okay.
Physical structure. Most capacitors consist of two electrical conductors in the form of metallic surfaces separated by a dielectric medium.
Define dielectric.
A dielectric is a non-conducting.
Got it.
So it can be made from glass, ceramic, plastic film, paper, mica, oxide layers, mylar, Teflon, or even air. Basically, the type of the dielectric determines the use of the capacitor.
And what it sounds like.
Sure. But, you know, depending on the use of the capacitor,
sure,
it may not necessarily be a sound application.
Fair enough.
So how does a capacitor work? The plate that connects to the negative terminal of the battery accepts electrons that the battery is producing. And the plate that connects to the positive terminal of the battery loses electrons to the battery. So once charged, the capacitor has the same voltage as the battery. So
what happens when it's charged?
Current stops flowing, unless there are other circuit elements. So if you put, like, for example, a light bulb.
Sure.
On the left side over here, between the battery and the capacitor.
Yes.
While the
capacitor... On the negative side.
Yeah, on the negative side. While the capacitor is charging, the light bulb will be lit. Once the capacitor is fully charged, the light bulb will go out.
And then depending on the capacity of the capacitor, that's how long it would take for it to fill up.
Yeah.
Yep. Cool.
So, that's a capacitor in a nutshell.
It's a way to create an off switch that happens automatically over a period of time.
Right.
Cool.
And uses for capacitors. So, there's energy storage. There's digital memory. Like, some of the earliest computers actually used capacitors as a binary memory.
They still do. I can't tell if you're visible on screen. Keep going.
I can't tell either. Pulsed power and weapons use capacitors.
Lean back a little.
I can't lean back a little. There's nowhere to lean.
You're in shadow is the problem.
Well, that's you in the light. Power conditioning, power factor correction, signal coupling and decoupling, high pass and low pass filters, and signal processing.
It's not true. A low pass filter is a resistor.
Resistors and capacitors are usually used in sequence, in series.
Yeah, okay. So next week you're going to walk us through the schematic of a high-pass and a low-pass filter.
Okay.
And you'll find that low-pass filters are resistors. Resistance creates a low-pass filter. Okay, signal. Okay, what's next?
So that's it.
Cool. So... All right, so that's how capacitors work. Let's move on to our section 3.
Yep.
This is our interview with Kyle Sherrod. I'm finally breaking these up into two sections. I think it's just better.
Okay.
So let's go to part one of our interview with Kyle right now. So we're sitting here with Kyle Sherrod. And
hi.
Hi. And Kyle's a little camera shy, which is why he sent the photo and we're recording the audio. But Kyle was nice enough to sell me the 688 for just about market rate, little bit of a deal. It was a win-win for everybody, right? You got this big honking thing out of your house.
Yep.
How long did it take you to pack this thing up?
I think... On a Sunday morning, it was a good sweaty 2.5 hours or so.
Two and a half hours. Yeah, I believe it. Thank you for taking the time. It came in. It took me about an hour to get it out of the box.
Yeah.
And then my trash can was full because you bubble wrapped the heck out of it.
Yeah, but you got all kinds of bubble wrap you could reuse when you're sending your neck or selling something.
Right. Right. And you were nice enough to throw a couple extra belts in. That's always the problem with these machines is the belts go.
Yeah, and Task Game doesn't even sell them anymore.
Really?
Or at least when I called them up last year to get belts for my machines, and they didn't have anything, which, you know, it seems kind of silly. I'm bitching about something, you know, 30 years old that doesn't have parts for it. But, you know, reality is like 5 years ago, I did buy belts from them for machines, and they did have them. But now all suddenly they've quit making them or quit selling them, and which is kind of funny because there's probably more people using these machines now than there were 5 to 10 years ago.
That's true. Yeah, we're kind of experiencing a renaissance of the tape. And I went cassette, but it's the, what's the big one? The 238 is what all the garage guys in San Francisco use?
The 388 is what the kids use.
The 388, that's right. That's a quarter inch reel to reel, right?
Yep, 8 tracks, quarter inch, 7.5 inches per second.
Was that the one that Bruce Springsteen recorded Nebraska on?
I believe so.
Yeah, or that, like that might have been a... That was a 4-tracker, though.
I think Beastie Boys did some stuff on there. The OCs are pretty popular with it.
Yeah.
Like, actually, I don't know if you read Tape Op, but the last month's issue had a picture of the OCs guy, and he's got a picture of him at his studio desk, and front and center is the 388, and I'm just looking at that, and I was like, that's what I should do, because right now my 388 sits on a shelf, plugged into the patch bay to go into my computer and stuff, but it's like, I should just have this thing front and center, because that's what I really want anyway.
Yeah, like in the... So everybody watches the podcast. This 688 actually sits behind Carissa on the show. And it's, you know, originally I set it up on a keyboard stand, and I was like, yeah, I'll do a project with it and then take it down and get it out of the way. But it's like, nope, this is a fixture now. This is just what I'm going to make records with.
And my cats like to run across the 388 or lay on it.
Oh, these knobs, they're so massaging. Yeah.
Yep.
That sounds like a cat. I'm lucky. I tend to keep the cats out of here, and they come in for the show, but they don't, and sometimes when we're tracking stuff, the Regal cat will come hang out. But yeah, they don't hang out in here when I'm not in here, and they know not to get on the stuff. There's a spot for the cat. That's
I have a pretty young kitten, and he thinks that where my studio is at's the best place, and so he climbs up the tower of keyboards, and it's like I have a 3-tier, you know, stand, and those aren't really the sturdiest on the best of days, and I'm like, don't do that, you're gonna knock that over and smash yourself.
Yeah. Yeah. I guess my first question is where is this picture we're looking at on this red carpet? What's the red carpet? What event were you doing?
So that was the premiere for the film Officer Down.
That's right. You did some work on Officer Down. What were you doing on that?
So I scored Officer Down, and I also co-wrote the theme song and a few other tunes that are in there alongside Clown from Slipknot and then my singer, Scott Lemon.
That's very cool.
It was pretty sweet.
Is that your first? Is that the first film you did, or have you been doing film work for a while?
It's my first, like, you know, formal film release. I've done some work on some indie stuff, but nothing significant.
Yeah, I know how that goes. I know exactly how that goes.
It was. I mean, technically, this is an indie movie too. It's just like probably on the bigger side of indie than you know what I was normally referring to as like a movie with no money, whereas this movie at least had some money behind it, but they made it without a studio, and then Magnet and Magnolia Pictures picked it up and put it out for us.
That's awesome. So did you join I assume you joined BMI then?
ASCAP.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's I would love to be on CSAC, but they don't seem to care about the fact that I want to be on CSAC, so there we have it. It's funny how that works.
Yeah, we're all on all of us that worked on it were on ASCAP already. It seemed like the thing to do at the time.
Yeah. Yeah, and BMI's better if you're doing like songwriting. If you're doing that kind of work.
Yeah.
But so that's very cool. So let's go through the history. So Kyle, how did you you play keyboard? Is that where you started as keyboard?
In life or on the movie?
In life. Yeah, let's start with there.
I was a band kid, and so I started on flute and clarinet and saxophones and all that stuff and jazz. And it's actually really funny, like I didn't get into contemporary music until probably later in life than I should have.
Yep.
And then in high school I picked up when I was in high school, Reason came out. Reason 1.0, and so I had a little computer that I built, and I had a pirated version of Reason, and which I do own it legally now.
In college we called them extended demonstration periods.
But so I had Reason and Rebirth, and so I started noodling around in that, and actually I would do the crudest things, like in Windows Sound Recorder. I would go in and I'd record like one line of dialogue or and then I'd put that in the sampler part of Reason, or I think it was in like the redrum, the drum module. I'd load the sample in there and I'd sit there and sequence all that and make songs like that very crudely. And
yeah.
So I'd make weird, of course that stuff just ends up sounding weird no matter who you are, I think. And so I did that for actually a couple class projects in high school, much to my classmates' dismay.
Yeah.
And so did that, and I and around that time, keyboard analog synths weren't like really expensive, but and eBay was brand new, and yeah. So and I had a job and I didn't have bills to pay.
So you started going around and buying up all the old keyboards.
So I bought a bunch of keyboards on eBay and filled up my bedroom, much to my parents' disappointment. And with not necessarily because analog was cool, because I don't think analog really was cool at that time, unless you had a really expensive art like a ARP 2600 or something. Well, at least that's what I wanted in high school, but never got. But
or a modular. Modular's always been cool.
But I had like a Juno and an SH-101 and things like that. And but I just bought that because it was cheap at the time. It was cheaper to buy that stuff than a Nord Lead or a Korg Triton or a Korg Karma or whatever else was hip and cool at that time. Because I think, I spent like $100 here, $100 there for most things that I bought on eBay. And then I went to school for recording technology in Minnesota, which was, of course, a great decision.
We just did an episode called Is Going to a Music School Worth It?
And, I don't think I went in there expecting to get a career or anything. I really wanted that for my own skill set.
Sure.
But of course it was a lot of money for my own skill set.
Yep.
And in retrospect, I probably should have done something else, but oh well. And I picked up guitar and all that junk along the way and had some bands here and there reach out to, when MySpace was cool, it was great. Cause I had a band and I could go and I could just email my favorite band. I'd be like, can I do a remix for you? And then I'd be like, sure, whatever. And it was awesome. And then once Facebook became the thing, it's like all this connectivity turned into hatred and people made social media what it is today, which is just, a flaming dumpster.
It really is a dumpster fire. I got to be honest. We were making the Paul Serrato record and I took the... He was here for, I believe, 6 days, and I avoided I avoided social media completely while he was here, right? He's an older guy. He doesn't really want to mess with that stuff. And I took a break from Facebook, and I got to be honest, it felt better. It's
pretty nasty. I loathe it. I'm only on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram to just because I feel like I'm supposed to be there, not because I want to be there because all the people that I want to talk to and hear about, I talk to somewhere else.
Yep.
And then, and I end up muting a whole bunch of people on Facebook not because I have a problem with people with different beliefs than me, but because
it just gets tiresome.
It's just exhausting. It's like, yep. You know, I don't want to sit there and look at this all day. Like I had to go on my phone. I think, you know, one of the automatic widgets is news.
Oh,
and I'm like, oh no, we've got to get rid of this. Like, and so that was good to get rid of that. And you know, like I have, you know, friends even that with the same political views as me, and they drive me crazy, and I have to mute them because it's like, why do you keep going on all these various controversial posts and doing your thing on that too? It's like, who cares? Just turn it all off.
Right. And the thing we should all remember is nobody's changing anybody's mind online. So, like, I got into a thing with the with some random stranger. He had said Jimi Hendrix is an overrated guitarist, so I just tore into him for a good 20 minutes. And it, you know, it's not that I'm against the idea of not enjoying Jimi Hendrix, right? Like, I get that. Not everybody's gonna love everything I love. But this guy, you know, he was carrying on about, he actually added a racial component to it, and then I start picking at him. I'm like, so who would you prefer to Jimi Hendrix? And he tells me Stevie Ray Vaughan. And I'm like, so you're telling me you prefer the white version of Jimi Hendrix? Way to go. Way to go. And this guy didn't even understand that Stevie Ray Vaughan transcribed Jimi Hendrix completely and then found his own, like, just frustrated. What am I doing? I'm doing it for sport. I'm doing it to feel superior to somebody else. It's not changing anybody's mind. But my whole contention was, it's not that Jimi Hendrix is overrated, buddy. It's that Stevie Ray Vaughan, your favorite, is underrated. So, but there's always this thing. There's this intellectual thing where it's very easy to just tear down everybody else. And that's simple and easy. And it doesn't take a lot of effort. But building yourself up takes a lot more effort. And that's why I think social media has turned so toxic.
I think it's, you know, people don't think there's somebody on the other line, maybe. I feel like on Facebook we're inside everybody's head. But, you know, it's not things that we would say to people's face, but maybe it's things that some people think, unfortunately.
Yeah. Yeah, it was a sad day when I found out a guy I went to high school with turned into like a really diehard, I guess the politically correct term is alt-right, but you know what I mean.
Sure.
He went down that way down that rabbit hole.
Yeah, and I mean, I know guys like that. Somebody went to high schools like the treasurer in some county in Iowa, which I went to school in Iowa, And he says, you know, says things like, finally, we have won over the empire. It's like, because he's a Star Wars and a, whatever guy.
Oh, Lord.
And I'm like, you know, I get that you like Star Wars. I'm not a big Star Wars guy, which we neither here nor there. But I'm like, I don't necessarily sure I understand your analogy. Like, you're taking down the empire by bringing this guy here.
By bringing in Emperor Palpatine. Yeah, I get it. That's got to... You're still in... where are you now? You're in Missouri?
Yeah, I'm in Kansas City.
That's right.
Which is... It doesn't... You know, maybe on the map it doesn't seem like an upgrade from Iowa, but I think it is.
Depending on the part... I mean, there's... I mean, what are you going to, in Iowa, you're going to be in what, Council Bluffs or?
Des Moines.
Des Moines, right? I have family in Dubuque. Dubuque's a beautiful town. But yeah, it's a much smaller world. In Kansas City, if you're a jazz guy, Kansas City has a great jazz tradition.
Like, you know, it's a difference. You know, we're like 10 times as big as Des Moines because Des Moines like population 257,000 or something. In Kansas City, it's like 2 or 3 million. And so I have friend, my singer and clown live in Iowa. And almost actually all the Slipknot guys, except for one of them or one or two of them, live in Iowa. And and they come down here and he's like, this is like L.A., kind of, which is, it's sort of funny because he went to, the singer and all those guys went to L.A. when we went to the L.A. for the premiere. And it's like, yeah, you know, the traffic, I drove when I was in L.A. And I was like, it's basically just as bad here, except for L.A. has twice as many lanes.
Right, that's LA is just they're relatively good at managing to keep it moving. It just moves slowly.
Right, and that's how like it, here it'll move slowly like that, and then my aunt and you know I have lots of family in Iowa. And they'll complain about rush hour in Des Moines, and it's like, are you kidding me? what is that exactly?
Austin, I dare you. I have to say about that.
Does that mean like Farmer Bob is out on the highway with his tractor or something?
There's a traffic jam. Jim's moving the combine.
Yep. I realize that's pretty prejudiced, but I feel like since I grew up in Iowa and lived there for 18 years, I can make that statement.
I like Iowa a lot. I find the politics of Iowa very interesting just because they, you know, they're the first in the primaries. They're actually the Iowa caucus is before the New Hampshire primary. I always find that fascinating. And it's also admittedly why we have so much corn subsidy is because Iowa grows so much corn. And so
it's soybeans
and soy. Oh God. Did you walk beans as a kid?
I did not. I considered, well, I think maybe you're talking about something else, but like they had like jobs for, I don't think you'd have to be 14, but they'd have, you could go out in the fields and
cut down the weeds,
do stuff for like Pioneer Hybrid and stuff, making science food. and you know, where I went to high school actually is literally down the street from Pioneer Hybrid. So I'm probably like genetically mutated. and probably all of our food was, well, definitely all of our food there was weird product.
Yeah.
But actually in Iowa, there's a studio an hour and a half northwest from Des Moines, and it's in a tiny town called Otho, Iowa. It's like, I think 900 people, maybe something. It's something really insignificant. And but there's a studio there that was built in like 1979, and it hasn't changed at all. And it's owned by a friend of ours, and he on this farm that he grew up on. And it's just, you know, obviously out in the middle of nowhere. It's built out of the chicken house. It doesn't look like the chicken house anymore. But he had a band called the Hawks.
Yeah.
And they were on like Columbia Records for
yeah.
a little while. And I think that basically paid for, you know, the studio. But then they got canned and whatnot. And so he's got this studio with like an, you know, he's got a couple 2-inch MCI machines. He's got a big MCI board and you know, rooms and a couple decent mics and a bunch of gear. Not necessarily like the sexy gear you think of when you on Gear Sluts or whatever. But it's a very vibey place. And so we'll go out there and we'll do stuff.
Listen, I will take 10. I will take 10 SM57s over one U87 any day of the week.
Right. And I mean, I've never been in love with the U87s at all. They just, I don't know.
They work on certain voices. They don't work on others. Just like any large diaphragm condenser. Like, they're just all over the place. But when I was building this rig, it was really more about adding capability. Where... I've always been on a quest to have enough like now I can record 16 channels simultaneous, and I can submix that down to 8 on the 688, which is great.
Right.
But when I was a kid, I could only do one or maybe a stereo pair, and now I get to do full bands live in a room, which is honestly the way I like to make records. Yeah, so I'm with you on that. And my room, it's a room full of stuff, but yeah, it's not the sexiest stuff. It's like, yeah, I got 20-year-old everything because
right.
That's what you can afford.
I mean, yeah, I have a rack that I have to take with me every time I go there just to transfer my stuff down to take it home.
Yep.
From tape, because he has a computer there, and that computer is probably 20 years old, and it only has a metronome program. And it has something, it has like some kind of primitive SoundForge or Secool Edit, something like that, like a two-track recorder, and he has it wired into a DAP machine so he can do like a stereo mix down.
I just got a DAT. I just got a Sony PCM2300. I'm very excited.
Probably about the same machine he's got.
Yeah. And they sound good. I mean, they get it's really ADAT. It was really the Alesis ADATs that sounded bad. DAT sounds all right. DAT was that whole Digilog thing with the
right
with the cassette. They do a DAT master, and then they would do duplication off of that digital, so you didn't have this extra generation of tape loss.
Mm-hmm.
So yeah, you were telling. So you have one of the early 388s, huh?
Yep. I'm down to one. I had three last year.
That's why would so were you doing anything with all three of them, or were you just hoarding them because, well, we're all hoarders. That's what an engineer is. We hoard good stuff.
The first one I bought in 2009 or 2008. I think 2009. And I don't remember why I bought it, because I don't think I had heard of it yet. I just saw a picture on Craigslist and was like, that's pretty sweet.
Yeah, you're like, oh, it's got reels. I want tape. Yeah.
Right, basically.
How do you tape?
At school, the school I went to wasn't like some community college where you learn in a closet or something. They actually had legitimate studios and reel-to-reel machines and boards and stuff.
So they taught you how to align them.
Learned how to align them and all that good stuff. You actually did get a real studio experience, even if you had to pay a whole lot of money for it. I got this thing, and it was from the band, the Republic Tigers owned it, and they used it for like a practice machine. I guess they would record their practices to it. And
that's a good use for them.
I think he was asking $500 for it. And I'm like, you know, can I give you 300? And he's like, whatever.
Get it out of my house. Yeah.
And so we got it. That's the first one. And that's like a average looking machine. All the lights worked, but I think one channel didn't work until I fixed it. Yeah, I fixed that channel. And and then my friend Clown, because I've been working with Clown forever. I didn't really go a whole lot into that, but I've been working with him forever as an engineer and also a songwriter and stuff. And so he called me up and he's like, can you come up here and bring Pro Tools, and we're going to record some in my basement and whatever. And
you're like, I can do one better.
Because his Pro Tools rig was, I think, in one of his warehouses or something, and so he didn't want to deal with it. And I'm like, well, I don't have a laptop, but I have this 8-track machine that I haven't really used yet. And so he's like, yeah, bring that thing up here, and so I did. And you know, that's like a 200-mile drive.
Yep.
And back and forth, and I'm like, you know, I don't really want to have to keep bringing this back and forth if you like it. But I think I left it there for a couple weeks, and I was like, you know, be very careful. I just paid for this, you know, don't break it. because he has a tendency to break things, and so he had it there, and then he's like, you should, you know, if you find another one, you should let me know, and I'll buy it. And so I found the other, I put a want ad on Craigslist, and some guy, 10 minutes from me, is like a church sound engineer, and he said he had one in his basement. And so I go and look at it, and it was like totally mint. Like, huh. the church bought it for one season of theater, and then I think ADATS or something came out, and they bought that instead, and then packed this thing away and never used it again.
So you pull this thing out of, like, the 688. The 688 came out of the box. I was like, this thing looks like it's brand new.
Well, this didn't have the box, but, yeah, this was in pretty ridiculously good shape.
Yeah.
And so I offered the guy $300, and he kind of hemmed and hawed at it for a minute, but then he took it. And so I bought that, and he also gave me a desk, which he made out of oak church pews.
Oh, wow.
And so then I immediately drove that one up to Des Moines, and my car rolled over 66,666 miles. And we took that in the clown's basement, and we wrote a song about the devil.
There you go. That's the one you sent me, wasn't it?
The Destroy Anything, I think.
Yeah. When we're done with this, make sure I have a link. And we'll put a card to it on the video so everybody can go listen to it.
Yeah, we're not really advertising that project so much anymore, but you can. I'll definitely send you another link.
Yeah.
We had a band called the Black Dots of Death, for one album on Sony, on like a division of Sony called Rocket Science.
Okay.
And then. They put out the album for us, which is fine and stuff. But then they folded and we had to buy back all of our remaining merchandise, which is pretty cool. in a you know, having a pallet full of your own CDs sort of way.
Yeah, I know exactly what that's like.
And I think we've actually gotten rid of all but a couple boxes, which I have a couple boxes in my garage. But Clown was like selling him on tour for like $5 or something. And so he got rid of a bunch of them. And it was kind of a weird project where we just kind of experimented a little bit. But somehow the 388 song ended up on there. Like, he took his 2-track from his laptop, some beat that he did in Fruity Loops, which is funny in its own way. He took the 2-track of that, and we put that into the 388. We printed, we did it twice, and then we had the singer record a whole bunch of takes across those two plays of the song. If that makes sense,
yeah.
And I transferred that down to the, you know, to the computer and mixed in the computer and comped everything.
So let's take a quick pause there. We'll go do our announcements, our goals, and a giveaway, so hang out for that.
And we're back. So we'll get back to Kyle, but I want to do our announcements, our goals, and a giveaway.
Yes.
So the first thing, our announcement is Freeform Fridays. The discs are now in production.
Yes. Yes, they are.
We've done our first 10. Those are getting shipped out to our first pre-order. If you want a copy of Best of Freeform Fridays 2016 on CD, they're $10 plus $3 shipping, because it cost me like bubble wrap and mailing and all that. Mm-hmm. So it's about $3. So the disc is $10. I will set up the store eventually, but right now the easiest way is just send $13 to paypal.me/thejazzdestroyers. And leave your address in the comments, and I'll put it in the mail for you. Mm-hmm. The second announcement is the Volca album is just kind of on hold right now. Though I think I'm going to do the next couple tapes to the 688 rather than the 4-trackers.
Okay.
That might help speed up the process, actually.
Yeah.
We just finished recording Sounds in Between, which sounds amazing.
Yes.
That record's going to be really, really great.
Mm-hmm.
We're about 3 weeks out from Freeform Friday's session 2 going up on YouTube. I've got 3 more videos to release from session 1, which we recorded in January. And then the February session we did at Cafe Creme, those will be the next batch of videos with Paul Serrato.
So those should be up, first week of April?
Yeah, lean back. You're still in shadow.
I think I'm getting shadow from the microphone.
Yeah, you are.
So
those will go up. And so really we're kind of in the middle of making the best of Freeform Fridays 2017. But that won't come out until 2018 because, you know, I got to finish the year out.
Yes.
So, but along with that, we recorded some stuff with Paul separately. And I'm still figuring out exactly how I want to put it together in a way where it's valuable to you guys as the consumer. But also, you know, we had a limited amount of time with Paul, so we couldn't record a ton of stuff. The other thing we're doing this week on Thursday, so if you're watching this, it's Wednesday as an individual clip. On Thursday, so tomorrow, we'll be recording Jomo and the Possum Posse at the Highball.
Yes. Again.
Again, at 8 p.m. Jomo wasn't thrilled with his performance, and the room was kind of empty on that one, so I get it. This is going to be a much bigger event. There's free spaghetti.
Free spaghetti, really?
Free spaghetti. It's a spaghetti western-themed night, and we're gonna drag all the cameras out. We're going to do it again. We're gonna record it all again, and it's going to be great. These guys they put on a heck of a live show.
Do meatballs come with the spaghetti?
I would imagine not. Okay. Those cost money.
Okay. Spaghetti's cheap, but meatballs cost.
Yeah. So then the next couple of things, 2006 and beyond, It's a Secret is going to take me a little while. I got to find the original. All I have are the MP3s of that. That's what I made the YouTube playlist on our YouTube channel with.
Uh-huh.
Which feel free to listen to that album. It's free to listen to on YouTube. But It's a Secret to Nobody and the Jazz Destroyers Live are both coming to physical release next.
Yes.
I got to get the layouts done on that, and then we'll start making physical copies of that.
Yes.
So if you're interested in copies of that, leave a comment, get in touch through Facebook, whatever. Just let me know, and I'll set them aside for you. Millicent Hughes, she's just about ready to start rehearsing for the May session. That's going to be a lot of fun. And then Your Name Here. I've got some time late summer.
Yeah.
Late summer into the fall, I've got time. So if you're interested in cutting a record with us, get in touch. Show me what you're doing, and I'm interested in hearing it. So those are our announcements. Also, we finally hit our 200 subscribers.
Woohoo!
Way to go. Thanks, guys. You guys are awesome. With that, I released the Volca album's tape number 2. So I made public 25% of that album.
Okay.
I'm not going to put the rest of it up publicly, so you're just going to have to buy the record when it comes out.
Yep.
Also, I'm putting all the cameras up, it turns into a big production, and I just need to focus on the music. So, but that's up. We are living in the age of neo-feudalism, which is a term I got watching Max Kaiser on RT. The feedback has been overwhelmingly positive. Everybody seems to really dig what I'm doing. So have a look at that. And we'll do another big thing for 300 subscribers. So that's our next goal, is how fast can we get to 300 subscribers? So the way you can help us get to that 300 is tell a friend, help them subscribe to this channel. And when we hit 300 subscribers, we'll do a big thing. And once we hit, I'm patiently waiting for YouTube to start letting us do live. And then we'll start, once I can figure out how to do live content on this channel, I will do some live content. But that'll probably just be hang out with Don while Don edits.
Yeah.
So those are our goals. Let's do our giveaway. We've got a download card. Set aside, it's what, 29 of 100?
Yes.
We got 29 of 100. Leave a comment. Use hashtag disco hoodie in your comment. And I'll stick that in a Get Off My Lawn record sticker in the mail for you. I'll get in touch for your for whatever address you want it sent to. And that's our giveaway. So let's get back to our Kyle Strahd part two.
Okay.
So we're back with Kyle, and I cut him off. I'm sorry about that.
Jerk.
Sorry. Let me ask you this. When you're working with these tapes, I'm pretty categorically opposed to doing the record multitrack into the computer, then bounce it to the tape, then bounce it back into the computer. I like to cut straight to the tape. Have you tried both ways?
I always do. If I'm going to use it, it's pretty much always straight to tape and then into the computer, with the rare exception that I mentioned previously. And then, and Sean was just, or Clown was basically using that, using his Fruity Loops out as like a drum machine out to us.
Right.
Not necessarily like he had written a whole song and then dumped it in there. But yeah, I'm usually about cutting it right to tape and then putting it into the computer when I'm relatively happy, or I know that I can't fix it on tape, which is another story.
Yeah, you can't fix anything on tape.
I've done some splicing, but I try to avoid it.
Yeah, I won't go anywhere near a razor blade with my tapes. Well, and I mean, if you're working on the 388 and you're working on quarter inch, you can splice it, but cassette, you're not gonna splice these little guys together.
Yeah, I've seen little cassette splicers if you're really motivated, but
oof,
no. Why bother?
I'm not that motivated. Just get it right on the way in. That's what I say.
Yeah, sometimes you're too drunk to make it right on the way in. Cause so I had like a project going for a little while that where I would record. I would put up a song every week that I recorded on the 388.
Yeah, I know exactly how that goes. That sounds like my Freeform Friday project.
And I think I did maybe 150 songs or something. And it was like maybe it was kind of loosely songs, because they're more like 50 seconds to 2.5 minutes in length, just depending on how silly I was at the time.
Okay.
And but I got the movie thing. I didn't have time to dick with it anymore. So I eventually ran out of material, because you know I didn't do that ever sit down one day a week and do this. I had sat down there on a weekend and did 15 of them or something, and then I'd have a big backlog of them, so I could just upload them as I went.
That's for anybody who's an aspiring YouTuber, that is the best piece of advice that I can give anybody. Is do batch processing. Make 10 videos, and then do the weekly upload. Because when we did Jesse Thunderwake, that film started as a web series. We were doing a daily upload, and we were doing some batch processing, but we really should have gotten ourselves 30 days out ahead, and then continued production. But once we got into filming the actual movie, we just had to stop. We couldn't keep doing the daily videos.
Yeah, that's what happens. Something else always comes up, and then you get into that thing, and then you get out of that thing, and you're like, I don't want to, you know, I'm all the way over there, you know, I got to turn that thing on and demagnetize it, and I got to figure out which cable goes where all over again and all that stuff. So it's kind of hard to, you know, I find it's best to like work in like a season of something, like, you know, let's do 30 songs or whatever, rather than try to stop and start a thousand different things.
By the way, there's 52 weeks in a year, there's 26 weeks in 6 months, and that means there's 13 weeks in every quarter, just in case anybody's keeping track. That's an important distinction, because I do that with Freeform, where I'm counting them up, and this year I ran over, I think, one or two weeks, which kind of worked out, because trying to get the first video out of the year, I really needed the extra week or so of time. But yeah, so anybody who's trying to do that sort of thing, it's definitely good to get a backlog started before you begin uploading, because otherwise you'll find yourself just out of material and out of time, and especially on YouTube, the algorithm punishes you if you don't consistently upload. So then it's not showing people your stuff. So let's change gears. How'd you get the film gig? How did you land this film scoring gig?
Mentioned earlier, like Clown and I have been working forever.
Right.
And so we have a band called another project called Brainwash Love, and we've been working on a record. And then he finds out where he, you know, a couple days before formal announcement, he's like, I think I'm going to get this film gig. I just got to pitch it and whatever. And he shows me the comic book and stuff. And he's like, send me the mix of the song that we were working on, which at the time the song was called I'm Fucking Angry. And it's, there's actually a funny teaser video from 2013 where he's talking about it, and there's pictures of the comics, and then there's a song you hear in the background. It's like, I'm fucking angry, and it's Clown. It's really funny and silly. But so when he finally met with the producers after he accepted this gig, we had gotten together with our now singer Scott Lemon, and we're like, you know, can you work this into a theme song, because we think we got a theme song here. And so he kind of, our singer kind of helped a lot to sort of figure out what we were instead of fucking angry, you know. But he played that to them, and he just kind of let it sink in for a little bit. But everybody's like, down, which is part of the song. And they were totally sold on it, and he's like, you know, let us do the music for it, and they signed up for it, and so that's pretty much how it happened. And but it took you know, 2.5 years or 3 years for the film to get financing after we announced it. So
yeah, I don't know what that's like either.
No, so we had to. So we had a little bit of time to think, but I had the comic book, and I could kind of sit there, and it's sort of an abstract process, but I would sit there with the comic book at home, and I'd be like, what do the telekinetics sound like, which are this group of disabled people, basically, that resurrect Officer Down in the movie with telekinetic powers.
Gotcha.
And so it's kind of like a weird, like, Matrix thing going on or something. I was like, what does that sound like? And so I'd sit there and I'd doodle with that, and I just kind of take it day by day. And then by the time Clown was shooting the movie, I had a bunch of things that he could take, and he could blast it while they're actually filming the movie. And that's pretty neat. So when they actually edited the movie, I actually saw it with my music and not somebody else's music on there. Which is unfortunately a more common scenario.
Yeah.
But he'd be like, you know, can you make me 11 minutes of murder? Which doesn't really mean a whole lot, but I would make 11 minutes of what I imagined murder to be at the moment. And then he'd go and he was telling me how he would do, you know, when you're shooting a movie, you need like the cool shots, and then you need like the coverage shots to make sure you have enough footage to make a movie, and you know, enough of the filler stuff when you can't just have 100% stylized stuff. And so he made like an 11 minutes of stylized murder, and he had my music to it.
That's
it was
very
pretty
cool.
Funny.
Yeah,
it didn't end up in the movie like that, but I'm not sure if that's like a bonus feature kind of thing or whatever, but
yeah, that's what I'm thinking. I'm thinking DVD special feature,
right? And so it's kind of it was an interesting process, you know, for a learning process deeply for me, because there's a lot of boring stuff that goes with the scoring too. There's a lot of paperwork.
Yep.
Not only like contracts, obviously, but then spreadsheets, like. You know, I have a massive spreadsheet dictating every single scene in the movie and how many frames that particular thing is playing, who wrote the song that's in that spot, if it's somebody besides me, so forth.
It sounds like you were also music supervisor on the project.
Only in some ways. We did pick a few songs. But there's like, so the opening scene in the movie, I won't tell you what it is, but there's this we definitely picked that song, which is a song we wrote called Hail.
Okay.
And it's basically about pussy. And so it hail
just
to
no
the pussy.
Grabbing. That's hail, no grabbing.
Yeah, this was before that.
Yeah.
So this and we thought about doing a version of that to make fun of that guy, but we decided not to. But so it's Hail to the Pussy. So we got that. We got this song perfectly fits in there. We got to do that. And then there's another scene in the movie where a guy comes out with a red ball gag in his mouth. And our friend that owns the farm studio in Iowa had this band in the early 90s, and he has this song called Mexican Tornado, which I think you can find a video for it on YouTube. It's a really, really silly DIY video, but so in that song he's like talking about a chili pepper in this woman's mouth, and I think it's basically about, you know, a woman with gas. And
sure.
So we picked that, we put that in there, and then we picked a couple stuff. But then there's some other songs, of course, that somebody else liked and decided to put in the movie that we didn't necessarily choose. So I wouldn't say I was totally music supervisor. Just here and there, we kind of nudged our ideas along as we could.
Yeah, y'all share. It sounds like you share the role, but the music supervisor, in many ways, is doing a lot of the paperwork. So if you're the one keeping the paperwork, there you are.
Well,
now did you do much writing cues? Did you write a lot of cues for the film?
Yeah. So obviously, when I got the edit of the film, there was some filler I needed. Or not really filler, but there were some blanks I needed to figure out how everything patched together. Because it was, you know, the movie does follow the comic book, but then it also has 30% more.
Oh, okay.
And so obviously I didn't know what those scenes were until I saw the movie. And so there's some empty gaps, and then kind of like bridging together, oh, this is a theme now. I can build this theme up here and there. See, it kind of like, you know, you're just kind of painting with the sounds and adapting it together. And then, and there's, you know, there's some cool cues, like with if you ever saw Dexter, the police chief from Dexter is in the movie.
Okay.
And so there's kind of like some brooding moments with her I'd put together. And, yeah, there's kind of a good mix of things that were written to comic and things that were written to picture, but you would be surprised how much of the stuff came from picture actually is more or less final in the movie too.
Hmm. Well, I imagine, especially if you had the music done before the edit, they might have done some editing to the music.
Right. Yeah, and that was a good reason for me to get everything, or to not get everything, but to get a lot of it going before all that stuff, because I didn't want them to get too attached to somebody else's music.
Right. Right. And then you start getting notes of like, can't you make it sound more like what we had in the mock-up?
Right. I never had, to be totally honest, I never had anybody say anything like that.
That sounds like a good working relationship.
I had Clown... Well, you know, Clown would listen to stuff I did, of course, and he had a couple notes here and there, but it was never like totally, you know, turning anything upside down or anything like that. He's more or less in line. Like, we've been working together so long that I think we kind of know what each other's are thinking.
Right. You build that when you build a long-term relationship with people like that.
Like, we had when we were doing Black Dots of Death, there was a period of time where he had some serious shit going on, and because he had just lost his bass player in Slipknot and some other things, and he would just, you know, be up in the middle of the night, can't sleep or whatever, and he'd write a song and he'd send me that song, and every night he'd do that, and then I would take it home and I'd do my thing to it and I'd send it back to him and he'd send me a new song, and we did that. We do that continuously, you know, back and forth over FTP. And so we have hundreds of songs.
Yep.
Just yep. like, just like that.
And it's great when you're having those moments. Do you find that you have these moments where you're very prolific and you're working on a lot of stuff and a lot of stuff's coming, and then you got moments where it's like, I can't figure out what the hell I want to do.
Oh yeah, and you get like, sometimes you get a little burnout, or you know, or just lose whatever was burning you on the inside for a minute, like kind of figure out, what am I even going to sing about today? You know, right. I was like, oh, I'm tired of, you know, I'm tired of the sky. I'm tired of the TV. I was like, how many times do I need to say the same thing?
Right.
And you know, how many times am I going to play the same damn thing on the guitar or whatever? You just kind of have to pick up something different and go from there and kind of force yourself to do something. Like I'd been after the movie, I'd kind of been out. We'd all been kind of exhausted for a while. And so I just started taking like I don't know about you, but on my phone, whenever I hear something weird, I'll record it. Hmm. And eventually the plan was to eventually do something with that. And I never did. And so I finally started emailing myself a few of those files. And I'd start trying to adapt songs out of that. And so I came up with some pretty neat things recently, just to try to get the fire burning again and find out who I am all over again.
Yeah, and you're talking about like found sound, or are you talking about right. Like you hear something weird on the radio?
Found sound, so where I work, my printer sounds pretty weird.
Yeah, and our printer here sounds pretty weird too.
And
yeah.
So it's like. And, you know, in a sort of weird way, it's like something like a between a Mellotron and a theremin or something.
Oh, that's pretty cool, yeah.
And so I took that and I put it into a program called Iris.
Sure.
And this is kind of weird sampler, and I just played that sound and made a little tune with that. And then there was like the roof was leaking at my work. And so drip into the buckets, and I'd record that pattern, and then I'd take that into like recycle, and chop it up and make a little drum pattern out of the water drops.
Yep, it's funny how that works.
Just trying to get out of the, you know, if I pick up the guitar, I'm probably gonna play the same thing, so if I gotta pick up something else to get somewhere else.
Right. Well, what I've always found what I always find that helps for me when I'm stuck, because I don't sing, right? Like, one of these days I'm going to release an album called Don Don't Sing. But, I mean, I can kind of sing, but I don't consider myself a singer. But what I always find with the guitar is I find transcribing helps a lot. Like, if you're stuck, you're in a rut, listen to something totally out of character for you and learn it note for note. And that usually knocks that sort of stasis out of you. If that makes sense. Like, for example, I don't listen to a ton of country music, but I picked up a gig out in East Texas this weekend doing country music. So now I have to learn a bunch of country licks and stuff, and I'm having a blast doing it. And even though it's not what I turn the radio on it to when I'm in the car, I find that doing the work and taking on new vocabulary, it'll just turn into other stuff.
Right. There's always something you can pick out of something. Even if you don't like it, there's always something you can glean off of it.
Right. Yeah, there's a Katy Perry song that has a nice little descending chromatic. Yeah, there's all sorts of stuff. And so that's always my advice, is like, just, okay, what do you listen to? Oh, you listen to metal? All right, go try some smooth jazz. Go transcribe a little smooth jazz, and then you'll come back to metal, and you'll have a whole bunch of new ideas.
Right.
And ultimately, having an expansive vocabulary, like, where I went to school, they really taught us to be chameleons. So I can do a country gig, I can do a jazz gig, I can do a rock gig, whatever. It's just music to me, and it's just, what accent are you playing with? And if you think of music as a language, you know, all this stuff is just accents. And And yeah, I find people get a little too hung up on their perceived genres. And I wish the world would kind of break out of that a little bit. Oh, you only ever listen to country music? Try some instrumental music for a minute. See how that goes.
And that's, this is kind of like, I mean, I started out with jazz and classical music. I didn't even think about contemporary music until like high school.
Right.
Yeah, and that by contemporary music, I just mean maybe music with vocals, and not necessarily the radio. Or it was like I went from like some kind of weird extreme John Coltrane and thing to like Skinny Puppy and
yep.
and Nine Inch Nails and Ministry and Pigface and all those assholes, and then I looped back to Queen and all these other guys, and I. Yeah, when Clown and I have done remixes and stuff, I'm kind of like, hey, that's a cool band, and I'll go out and buy their record and I'll listen to them, even if it's like we did. I don't know if you know D'Antwoord.
Yes, D'Antwoord. Yep.
So we did a remix for them back in their first album. I think it was right before their first album dropped. We did an Enter the Ninja. Remix, and yeah. It's really funny. The story is really funny to me because Sean had me work on it with him, and they basically turned it down.
Really?
Because he gets
DJ High Tech with his next level PC was
right with his next level copy of Fruity Loops or something. Whoever shuts down remixes, shut it down. I don't know if it was them personally or their suits or something. It's pretty wild and extreme remix. I don't know. It's really tough to describe, I guess. But we were kind of going for something a little crazy because they were crazy at the time. So we wanted to see how crazy we can make them. I probably never would have listened to them if I hadn't done that remix, but now I buy their records and I saw them a year or two ago, and it was a lot of fun.
Yeah, I remixing is one of those things where like you would actually go reach out and be like, hey, I like it, can I do a remix, and they'd go yes. And you traditionally start with what, the two track, or do you ask them for multi track?
They would generally send stems.
Yeah.
So I had stems of if it's a Clown remix, then I would definitely have stems because he only does real stuff. But if it was me off of picking up people off of MySpace, it wouldn't always be that. It'd be like I did a remix for a side project for the guy Dean Garcia from Curve and Eurythmics.
Okay.
And he sent it, and it was like a kind of like a some kind of electronic thing, but then it'd have like a one of those vocal tracks that only existed in the chorus and there's no other vocals in the song. They were recording when they had headphones on and the headphones were way too loud, so it'd be all this bleed in there, and I'm like, you guys don't have a cleaner track of this to you.
Nope.
So it was, but that stuff doesn't matter really. It doesn't in the context of the song. You can usually make that stuff disappear.
By the way, do you know the trick to remove headphone bleed? Because either you got to use, like, I have a pair of Vic Firth headphones, which are basically like hearing protection for guns, but then they stuck speakers in them. That's one way to do it, but the way they traditionally do it is you'll have the singer stand there wearing the headphones, listening to the track, and not singing.
Right.
And you record that, you line it up, and you invert the phase, and it cancels out.
Yep.
So that's my pro tip for... I'm pretty sure we get a few people who are interested in music production watching this show. And I don't do a ton of, like, tutorials, and I'm not sure I want to go down that route. But I like to give the pro tips and let everybody in on the inside baseball, if you will.
Right. And now that I'm older, more experience. I'm just like, you know, fuck it. I love the bleed.
I love the bleed too. That beautiful Christina Aguilera, they opted to not remove it for that exact reason. It's just, it just sounds, you know, at the same time, I don't like headphones in general. I'm headphone averse. I don't like things on my ears. So I like to record things. Vocals, you can't really, unless you put the singer in the room with the musicians, in which case you're going to get nothing but bleed. You know, you're going to need some headphones, but I prefer to do everything live in a room versus overdubbing my way into stuff. But everybody's got their own process, so I don't poo-poo on other processes. It's just not the way I like to make records. But you do quite a bit of overdubbing, don't you?
Oh, yeah. I kind of have to.
Yeah.
And, I mean, because I almost never have, like, a full band of my own put together just because it's... I'm sure you... know the same thing. It's really hard to find people that care as much as you do, and it's not even about whether or not they can play or whether or not they can play the right instrument that you want them to play. It's whether or not they care
about the project. Yep.
about the project and have the time to invest in it and so forth. It's like just trying to, if I get somebody, you know, it doesn't even matter their skill level, and they blow off practice and whatever constantly. It's like that totally burns me out and puts me in a bad world. And so I end up playing almost everything on a lot of stuff just because I don't want to go out there and deal with the drama. But it's so, you know, Clown and I do a lot of stuff together, but then it's great that we picked up a singer that can kind of do things that I really can't, because you probably notice that I don't have the lowest range,
right?
But we have the singer that's got, he's kind of like Scott Weiland or something like that. He can do a lot of stuff that we can't, and kind of gets our heads out of the game for a little bit, let somebody else put their mix on it, because, you know, kind of music and art is really we. It's not me necessarily, you know, something, whatever I'm working on by myself, it always becomes so much better when somebody else puts their thing on it.
Yeah. And that's how I came to free. That's how I came to this Freeform Fridays thing, is like, just do your thing, man. You know, I try to bring in people that aren't specifically jazz players as well as jazz players. You know, the jazz guys, we all have really big ears, so it works, but yeah, you bring in somebody who maybe is less comfortable in that idiom, and all of a sudden they're kind of driving the boat, and they're adding a unique sound to it. And yeah, to me, music's a collaborative process. I famously, and I got a lot of flack for it, but I famously point out my point of, I believe art is where the artist and the audience intersect. So
right.
So when an artist makes something with artistic intent, they're making artistic output, but it doesn't become art until the audience reacts to it. And that's what I believe. So for me, I'm just a collaborative kind of guy. I like to do stuff with a lot of people, but I'm an in the room kind of guy. I'm you're describing sending stuff via FTP back and forth, and I'm going, oh God, no, I would never do that. Never again.
Well, it works out because, like, Clown's only, you know, he's Clown's awake with very specific times that are not always what my hours of operation are.
That makes sense. Yeah. And either you're going to have to adjust your sleep schedule or do this.
Right.
Yep.
And so, it's kind of neat because sometimes he'll do something in Fruity Loops, and you're like, Fruity Loops, you know, whatever. But it's kind of cool the way he uses the, you know, he plays drums behind a kit. He doesn't just play things with a baseball bat and whatever. He actually plays a kit,
right?
In our other projects, and that's really cool, and that's one thing. But then he programs drums, and it's like an alien program the drums to me. It doesn't sound like anybody else programmed those drums. Like, if I program the drums, it from whatever reason, probably because I don't use Fruity Loops, it doesn't come out like that. But and then he'll like play guitar, and he's not really a guitar player, but he kind of he understands the sounds. He's playing, I think, you know, for sounds and how they connect together rather than chords and scales and how those connect together.
Sure.
And so he kind of plays it from a totally different angle, and then he'll send me that tune, and I'll be like, what the hell is he doing? How does he tune? Because he'll just sit there and twiddle the tuning peg until he's happy, like Joni Mitchell or something. And then I'll go to his house, and he'll have like 3 or 4 strings left on the guitar. And I'm like, all right, we got to put some strings on this thing. but it's kind of, you know, it's just kind of like having a, you know, if I played the guitar part, I wouldn't have done the same thing at all. He got somebody that's doing making alien parts on there. But that's why it's great to have a, you know, anybody as an outside influence, whether or not, you know, it's just necessarily you're the, you know, most skilled person. But I find that a lot of people can come up with unique things just given the opportunity.
Yeah. Yeah. So, Kyle, that's an hour. We're going to move on to our shout-outs. But before we do, we do so much talking about ourselves on these podcasts. I like to do 3 shout-outs. So do you have 3 shout-outs off the top of your head?
I sure do.
Okay.
No, I don't. I'm just kidding.
All right. Well, I'm sure everybody who worked on the movie, Clown, and probably your parents.
Oh, maybe not that far.
Okay.
No, you know, Scott Lemon, you know, I bring him up a whole bunch, but, you know, with his work on the theme song, I think really helped us finalize the decision to let us do the music. You know, and Chris Burnham, who drew the comic book that Officer Down is based on, you know, really, I think, instrumental in getting all this put together. And, you know, Clown for having faith in me, despite not having tons of formal film experience.
Yeah.
Was really appreciated.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So thanks for coming on to the show. We're going to have links in the description, a couple cards to take a look at if I can get around to doing the cards, but we'll definitely put links in the description. And what is the social media of your preference? You don't really do a lot of YouTube.
I don't have anything on YouTube right now, I don't think. But Twitter / music by Kyle or at music by Kyle.
At music by Kyle, sure.
Yeah, that's the easiest way to get to me. And then I just have a regular website that's musicbykyle.com, but it's honestly probably easier just to reach me on Twitter.
Okay. So if anybody's working on their film and they need somebody or just wants to talk to you, that's Twitter's the way to go. So Thanks for coming on the show, and let's move on to our shout outs.
Cool. Thanks for having me, Don.
Absolutely. All right, so that was great. Kyle's a really interesting guy. I had a really good time talking to him. Mm-hmm. And sorry about the language. I know I try not to curse on the show, but I'm not going to censor my guests. That's just how that goes. So, kids, don't repeat some of those words, but it was pretty interesting. So let's move on to our shout-outs.
Okay.
You've got 3 shout-outs. What are your 3?
My first one is to Vlasic.
The Pickle Company.
The Pickle Company for making dill pickle relish, which makes making tuna salad so much easier when I don't have to shred the pickles. So, thank you. Thank you so much for that. Second shout out, this is kind of a sarcastic shout out, to Studio Cat.
# Studio Cat. Though Studio Cat you can find on Instagram.
Yes.
# Studio Cat.
Yes.
Under the Jazz Destroyers page.
Yes.
Everybody's got upset tummies.
Everybody's got upset tummies. He decided Friday night, or sometime Friday, that he was basically going to puke all over my side of the bed. And so I come home to find that and then him lounging on Dawn's side of the bed.
Yep.
Like, nothing was wrong. So.
He knows better than to puke on my side of the bed.
So thanks, Studio Cat.
Yep.
And then the third semi-sarcastic shout-out would be to Wriggle Cat, which I'm sure she's also on Instagram under hashtag Wriggle Cat.
Hashtag Wriggle Cat. You can find her on Twitter and Facebook as well.
Is she on Twitter? I did not know she was
on
Twitter.
You can find Studio Cat on Facebook as well, but you should definitely go follow the Jazz Destroyers on Instagram because that's where I post a lot of pictures of this room when I'm in here and taking creative shots and things.
Mm-hmm.
There's a lot of exclusive content on the Instagram.
Yes. So, yeah, yesterday Wriggle Cat also had an upset tummy. And at least she was good enough to jump off the couch and go puke on the floor.
Yeah, you don't puke on my nice American couch.
You don't puke on my furniture.
I specifically tracked down a couch that was made in America.
Studio Cat has not learned this lesson. Wriggle Cat has learned this lesson. She's a good kitty.
Yep. She's right here, but I'm not running the cat cam this week.
Yeah, she's not doing anything exciting. She's just laying there.
Yeah.
So, yes, those are my three.
Cool. So my first shout-out is going to be to David Tucker. Thank you for having us out at Teague's. My second shout-out is to the entire city of Round Top, Texas. All 100 of y'all. It was great playing for y'all yesterday. That's just a great town. I like playing there more than I like playing Austin.
And I would like to thank them because he came home and had finally managed to drop the G at the end of Darland.
Yep.
I've been trying to get him to do that for a good 10 years now.
I also now own a cowboy hat.
Yes.
And I just dropped a memory card.
Yeah.
And then my third shout out is always to the Get Off My Lawn Records family on Facebook. That's our Facebook group. You can join it. You should totally join it. I put exclusive content. I don't overpost. And this way, you can kind of know what's going on before everybody else. So those are our shout-outs. If you have any shout-outs, leave a comment. And if you'd like a shout-out, leave a comment. Absolutely. Yes. Right? I love shouting out new subscribers and things. That's always great. And let's move on to our Section 7. This one is Everybody Gets a Trophy. Now, I don't usually leave this on an individual clip. So the first trophy goes to the audience for hanging in there. You get the Hanging In There award.
Yes.
Way to go, guys. You stuck through. This is now exclusive content to you. So there's got to be something exclusive, some Easter egg we can hide in here. Nah. So
we'll find something.
We'll find something. But I want to give you the Perseverance Award. I know it was pretty hard to get to the podcast and get going on this today.
Yes, yes, yes. It was rather difficult.
Yep. It's a way to go. Hey, that's Wriggle Cat right there.
Yep. She finally decided to join us.
Yes.
Officially. Okay.
That's our Easter egg for the Everybody Gets a Trophy.
Yeah, see who get to see a kitty.
She's very cute.
Yes. And you, you get the Cuddle Time Award.
The Cuddle Time Award?
Yes. Because any time this morning that I had anything even remotely approaching motivation to get up,
I didn't.
I was being cuddled by two cats and a husband.
Yep.
So, yes.
So, yeah. So that's our show for this week. And on that note,